In the previous lessons, we have seen the structure of Heidenhain CNC, started the first program, and defined the blank to be machined. In this lesson, we will go a few steps further and define the tool we are going to work with. So let's not waste any more time. I'm Gabriella, he's Paolo, and this is CNC, of course. As a first step, I would say we restart the simulator, edit the program started in the last lessons, and continue from the blank parallel pipe. Do you remember, Paolo, how to do that? Well done. Editing, program management, enter. Bravo. At this point, the first thing we need to let the numerical control know is which tool we intend to work with. To do this, we need to know what the tool table is and how to edit it. To access the tool table, we can operate in manual, an electronic hand wheel, or in execution modes. By pressing the soft key at the bottom right, you can access the tool table. At this point, the table opens, in which the parameters of the tools to be used are defined. There is a lot of data to set, and depending on the machine builder, you can find more or less fields. Now, let's focus on the main fields. We have a first column indicating the tool number. This is the first way we can call it in our programs. In the second column, you enter the name of the tool, which is also the name by which the TNC may call the tool as an alternative to the number. The name must be a text with a maximum of 32 characters for the 640 control and the 16 characters if you are using a 530 control. As in the case of file names, space and graphic signs other than line and dash are not permitted. Next is the column for tool length, which is the distance from the spindle nose to the cutter tip. In the next column, we find the tool radius, which will have a multiple function for the control. It will intervene when the radius compensation function is activated. Then it will be the fundamental data for the management of certain fixed cycles, such as pockets or studs, and finally, it will be used for representation of the tool in graphic simulation. There are many other fields to follow, which we will address from time to time as we need to. What, Paolo? Right, Paolo. The tool table is not linked to the positions that you have available in the magazine. Therefore, you can define as many tools as you like without any problems. And using the pocket table, you can manage the physical positions within your tool magazine. Going to pocket table in the first column on the left, you will find the position of the magazine. And in the second column, the associated tool. Then, the name. If you are using the simulator, you should have the tool table already pre-configured. We will also use this structure, avoiding variations so as not to penalize the demo programs already inserted. If your table is not already filled in, let's see how to enter the data together. To edit or enter data for your tool, press the Edit On soft key. Go to the field you want to define. For me, for example, it could be free position 57. We write mill, diameter 10, finish. Then we move to column L and write the length. Imagine we have measured it and write 100. Then we indicate the radius in column R by writing 5. The next column, R2, is used to describe the toroidal radius. The information is mainly used for graphical simulation and compensation of the toroidal radius on 3D profiles. We will indicate 0. Next, you can enter wear values for both length, radius, and toroidal radius. Here again, we will leave the fields at 0. But remember that the values you enter will be added to the length, the radius, or the toroidal radius values. Now, let's go back to the program we started in the last lessons. We said that firstly we need to call the tool we want to work with. We look at our keyboard and press the tool call key. As always, at the top of the screen, we can see what questions we are being asked, and the first request is which tool I need to call. At this point, we can choose whether to enter the number or the name of the tool that we have previously defined. If we do not remember in which position we have loaded our tool, we can use the soft key at the bottom right, Select, to select it directly from the table. Enter it, move inside with the keyboard arrows, and select. The tool we call is T57. At this point, it asks for the tool working axis. Most of the time, it is the Z axis as defined by ISO standards. It may be necessary in some cases to define a different working tool axis, but for now, we will remain with the most typical condition. Remember that defining Z as the working axis, the NC automatically recognizes the XY plane as the working plane. All clear, Paolo? Perfect. This information may seem obvious, but it is actually very important because this is where tool length compensation is activated and the fixed cycles for drill, pockets, slots, etc. are oriented. The control understands that the depths have a Z direction and the X axis will assume the role of the main axis of the working plane. We always confirm with Enter. At this point, you are asked to define the number of revolutions per minute, identified by the letter S as spindle speed, at which you want your tool to work. You can either enter the value you have previously calculated, or if your control is a TNC 640, you can use the calculator provided in the soft keys. Let's suppose, for example, that we want to machine our 10 diameter end mill at 140 meters per minute, then enter radius 5, and in the cutting speed field, enter 140. The result obtained with the internal calculator can be entered automatically in the program using the soft key at the bottom left. Confirm with Enter. Here we close the minimum necessary fields of the tool call and could close a dialog by pressing End. But if you are as curious as Paolo, then we can move on. F stands for feed, in this case, machining feed. By inserting it here in the following blocks of the program, it will be enough to call it up with the F auto instruction. Here too, we have an internal calculator that allows us to calculate our value and insert it directly into the program. Let's open the calculator, and as you can see, it still has the previously calculated RPM in its memory. All we have to do is enter the number of cutting edges of our tool and how much we want to remove per cutting edge. Our tool has 4 cutting edges, and we set 0.05 millimeters per tooth. Alternatively, we can also define the chip removal per revolution, in which case we do not need to fill in the field for the number of cutting edges. Enter the calculated value into the program using the soft key. Confirm with Enter. Then we encounter the DL and DR fields, which give the option of entering a correction to the tool length or radius. You are right, Paolo. Let's try to explain it well. We can say that the values we enter in the table refer to the geometric dimensions of the tool, whereas in the program, it is a purely programming matter and therefore, for example, it is a way of managing the roughing allowances. When the TNC needs to compensate for the tool radius or the tool length, it does the exact calculations of the values L from the table, DL from the table, and finally DL from the program. The same applies to the radius, and consequently also to the toroidal radius R2. This concludes the tool call function, which in the execution mode corresponds to the start of the physical tool change process plus the loading of tool values. What do you think, Paolo? You're right. Even today, we haven't seen my chips. But as you can see, I have a lot of information to give, and it's necessary to open and close many parentheses. The important thing is that everything is clear. Is everything clear? Will you be there at the next lesson? Noted.